I'm Will Wilker, and I'm going to show you a way to do drone mapping with free and open source software. So if you've ever done much drone mapping, that is flying a drone and then compiling the images together to create a map that's geo-referenced, or creating a textured object like an OBJ file or point cloud. So if you've ever done much of that and looked at the software, or you wanted to, you probably choked a little bit on the price. And so I've been doing drone mapping for a good year now, pretty much since the new FAA license became available. And prior to that, I was doing it recreationally for fun. So what I'm going to show you is a tool chain that uses free and open source software to accomplish pretty much what software like Pix4D or Drone Deploy or some of the other softwares out there do. It's been a little bit hard to access for a typical computer user because it runs from the command line, but more recently they've come up with a browser-based graphical user interface that's a lot more user-friendly. So installing it is a little more complicated than what you might be used to, because you can't just download it and let it rip, but you will be installing it in Docker, which is a sort of a container environment that runs in a virtual machine. So this program can be installed natively on Ubuntu Linux or in Windows and Mac. You can run an instance of Docker, which in turn runs in a virtual machine, and then you can have this browser-based GUI that basically what it does is it spins up a server on your local machine, and then you upload, even though you're not loading over the internet, you upload into the server your batch of pictures, and it processes them, and then you're able to then download the assets, and you're going to have a geo-referenced TIFF image. You'll have a textured object or a textured mesh with a, you know, in the format of an OBJ file. You'll have LAS files, which is a point cloud for programs like CAD, AutoCAD, and some other files as well. Typically what I use, I do a lot of environmental wetland mapping and some industrial stuff for pile volumes and stuff like that. And the measuring tools in OpenDroneMap aren't quite as well developed as what you would find in some of the paid products, but they're getting there. They're getting to the point where you can do area measurements and get an acreage. And so they don't have volume pile measurements yet, but that's kind of on the agenda for them. So I'm going to break this up into various videos so you can skip the parts that you probably already know about. For example, if you're very familiar with running Docker containers on your machine, then you can probably skip the video on installing Docker. And then basically the way the tool chain works is you fly your drone, and incidentally you could also use a cell phone to do a 3D scan. For example, I'll show you an example of a 3D scanned rock I did just freehand with a cell phone, and then processed the images through OpenDroneMap. So you take your batch of images, and what you'll be doing is uploading it into the browser-based GUI of OpenDroneMap, and then it will run the process for a matter of hours, depending on how large your project is or how many pictures you've got. So for example, I've seen maybe like a 70 picture data set from my Phantom 4 process in under 2 hours. And then when it's done, you'll be able to download these different assets, and the geo-referenced TIFF will be able to be used for something like QGIS or ArcGIS, if you use that. QGIS is the open source version of mapping software. It's layer-based, raster-based mapping software that I don't do a lot with it, but I basically know what it does. And then you'll also get the 3D textured mesh, which I end up using these more. And what I'll be showing you how to do is then import that into Blender. And then once in Blender, you can do some serious editing, really anything you want. You can do cropping, you can edit the texturing. So for example, when it's output from OpenDroneMap, it has a large number of textures, and I'll show you how to go in Blender and bake that all into one single texture if you want to do that. And then from Blender, we'll be using the Blend for Web add-on to export it into an HTML file. So you can basically have a 3D textured object using the WebGL technology of modern browsers. It'll export directly from Blender into an HTML format that can go right on your web page, or just give you a self-contained 3D object to share. So sometimes if you're scanning a property, you fly your drone and maybe it's a house or a farm or a gravel pit, and you want to share that with someone who doesn't deal in 3D software. They don't have Blender, or they don't have AutoCAD or whatever. So what we can do is take that textured mesh object and export it right into an HTML file that anyone with a browser can just open up and look at. And Blend for Web also has, Blend for Web is an add-on for Blender, and it has a number of tools that get more into making it interactive, like you could make a full interactive scene or a full interactive application. So we'll get into that in some of these videos in this series. So take a look in the description. This is it's sort of a large project, so if you're new to some of these things, you're going to be learning some new words. If you're new to the command line, you're going to have to type just a little bit, not too much. If you've never run a virtual machine on your computer, you're going to learn about that. It's not too tough. It's a little bit interesting setting it up, and take a little time and be patient if you're new at this. But then again, it's not that hard either. And once you get it set up, it's easy. You don't have to set it up every time. You just fire it up and process your images and you're done. So getting it set up is a little difficult for an average computer user if you're not used to the command line and virtual machines. But that's not hard. I mean, if you can watch a YouTube video and type, you can do this. So just be patient and expect a few unexpected things to happen when you're doing this. I know when I was rushing through it to get my first batch done, you know, you skip some steps, and I'm fairly new to Docker and virtual machines, so I had to get a little bit familiar with those. So as a consequence, you're definitely going to find updates and corrections to this video. So keep an eye on the description, especially if the upload date is, especially if this video has been up for a while. So do check the description for updates and corrections, and I'll put those in there because they're going to happen. It's inevitable. OpenDroneMap is under heavy development. I'm new to Docker. I'm new to OpenDroneMap. So there's going to be definitely some shortcuts and maybe even, complete better ways of doing this. So keep an eye on the description, and I'll list out any updates and corrections that need to occur. Now, this video is part of a series, so I've broken this up into a number of videos so you can pick and choose the part you need to look at if you're familiar with some of these areas. For example, if you know how to go into your BIOS and enable virtualization on your machine, you can skip that part. It's not hard, but if you've never done it before, it helps to watch a video. And Mac, you won't need to do that. So this works on Mac or Windows. I've successfully run OpenDroneMap on Mac and Windows. I haven't done Ubuntu Linux yet, but that's probably next on my agenda. So what I'll do is, in the description, I will link the whole set of videos, and you can go through them and watch them in sequence, or just the ones you need for your information. So here's basically a flow chart of how this technology goes. You start off with the batch of images that you acquired with your drone, and most of my images are done with a Phantom 4, and I've got a Phantom 3 that I use sometimes. Or you can also start with a set of images from a 3D scan. The only difference is the 3D scan is not going to have GPS data. So when the processing is complete, OpenDroneMap will give you the option of looking at your scan, at your map, overlaid on Google. And if you do a 3D scan, it's not going to have that preview option. But if you've got your drone pictures and they're all geotagged, you can go ahead and process those. And once the processing is done, then you can view your map and you can see the completed geo-referenced map, and you'll have the ability to do area measurements on it. And so then at that point, you can go ahead and export all those assets. And from there, the GeoTIFF, if you want to, you can just pull that into something like Photoshop and convert it to a JPEG if you just want to give somebody a picture, you know, crop it and give them an aerial picture of their property or whatever. Or you can pull that into QGIS, which is open source mapping software that's very well developed. And then you can also then take the textured mesh and we'll import that into Blender, which is a very, very well developed and powerful open source 3D editing software. It's has far more abilities than we'll be touching on today. And then once in Blender, we can do editing, we can crop, we can edit each individual vertex, you know, we can do editing to the lighting. If it was a dim day, I'll show you how there's ways to adjust the environmental lighting and make it look like it was a sunny day. And then we can do texture baking, so we can take all the various textures that got applied during the processing and go ahead and bake that into a single texture. It can help the file size. And then we can export that model into an HTML file using Blend for Web. And if you'll notice on this diagram, you'll see even there's a VR headset. That's an HTC Vive. And Blend for Web even has the ability to create a virtual reality scene that you can enter and interact with. And I have a good example of that. I've recently put up a video with the demo, the virtual reality demo they have on their site, so I'll link to that in the description as well. So basically that's the tool chain, starting off with a 3D scan or a drone map, and then what you end up with is either a map in QGIS or a textured mesh in a format that's easy to share. That's essentially what we're looking at here. So go ahead and browse through the videos in the description and pick the ones that touch on areas you're going to need to know about and look through them and see what you think.